Hello everyone, today's subject is programming in Java and it is taught in MCA third semester. I am Poonam Sani from the Department of Computer Science and Engineering. Today I will give you a brief introduction about Java. Now the objectives of this lecture are history of Java, bytecode, we will discuss the terms JVM, that is Java Virtual Machine, compilation process for Java program, what is Java technology and its goals, what is the garbage collector, Java runtime environment, Java software development kit, IDE, that is integrated development environment, and then the features of Java. So first we will start with the history of Java. See, before starting with this 1990s, let us discuss before that year. Actually, there were machine instructions that worked in case of few hundred instructions only. Then to deal with the large and complex programs, assembly language was invented. That is the symbolic representation of machine instructions. As programs continued to grow, to handle the complexity, high level languages were introduced. Now, in 1960s, the structured programming came into existence with the help of C. It helped in writing complex programs easily. But when a program reached a certain size, suppose 25,000 instructions, then it is difficult to manage that program in C. To solve this problem, the concept of object-oriented came into existence. Now, what is object-oriented programming? It is a programming methodology that helps to organize complex programs through the use of inheritance, encapsulation, and polymorphism. So, C++ includes, C++ is an object-oriented language and it includes all the features of C and the benefits of object-oriented programming. So, in 1990s, putting intelligence into home appliances was thought to be the next hot technology. So, what we want to do? We want to create some software that is to be embedded in various consumer electronics devices like microwave ovens and remote controls, and different types of CPUs are used in these appliances. So, anticipating a strong market for such things, Sun Microsystems in 1991 funded a research project whose goal was to develop software for intelligent home appliances. And intelligent home appliances intelligence comes from its embedded processor chips and the software that runs on the processor chips. Appliance processor chips changes often because engineers continually find to make processor chips smaller, less expensive and more powerful. To handle the frequent turnover of new chips, appliance software must be extremely portable. Portable in the sense that suppose you have created one chip and that can be embedded in any type of appliances. That is the portability. Now, initially, Sun Microsystems planned to use C++ for its home appliances software, but they soon realized that C++ was less than ideal because it wasn't portable enough and it relied too heavily on hard to maintain things called pointers. Now in case of C and C++, the pointer, we use pointers to they directly access the hardware. So all the languages before Java generates the object code on compilation. In case of C and C++, when we compile the source code, it is converted into object code and that is not portable. So object code is comprised of binary format instructions. So those binary format instructions are intimately tied to a particular type of computer. Suppose I have created a source code at machine X and compile that code on machine X, then it will run only on that machine only. So that is not portable. That the code that is running on computer X will not run. It is not necessary that it will run on computer Y. So thus, rather than write C++ software and fight C++'s inherent deficiencies, Sun has decided to develop a whole new programming language to handle its home appliance software needs. So their new language was originally named Oak. So the interesting thing is that the James Gosling has invented this language but it was soon changed to Java. So web pages now in that era there was the advent of World Wide Web and internet, and portable programs were required. So web pages have to be very portable because they can be downloaded on any type of computer. Because on the internet there are number of machines that are connected with each other, and they have different software and hardware configurations. So Java programs are very portable, and they are better than HTML in terms of providing user interaction capabilities. So Java compilers do not compile all the way down to object code. In case of C and C++, when we compile the source code, it generates the object code directly. But in case of Java, the source code is first compiled to the bytecode, which processes the best features of both object code and source code. So Java compiler compiles the source code and generates the bytecode, and then the interpreter, Java interpreter, will interpret the bytecode and convert it into object code. So like object code, bytecode uses a format that works closely with computer hardware, so it runs fast. Like source code, bytecode is generic, so it can be run on any type of computer. So it has given Java the ability of portability. Java programs that are embedded in web pages are called applets. Now the next term, that the term that I have used in my last slide, that is bytecode. Now what is bytecode? Now bytecode is nothing but the intermediate representation of Java source code, which is produced by the Java compiler by compiling the source code. So it is a machine independent code. Bytecode is a machine independent code, and it is not a completely compiled code, but it is an intermediate code somewhere in the middle, which is later interpreted and executed by JVM, that is Java Virtual Machine. That term we will discuss after this one. Bytecode is a machine code for JVM, but the machine code is platform specific, whereas bytecode is platform independent. Now when we write a Java program, we save that Java program with in a file with an extension .java. When the Java compiler compiles the code, it will generate a .class file. In .class file we have the bytecode. So the .class file is created after compiling the source code. So that is our bytecode, and that is required for, that is the main feature of your Java. Now what is JVM? Now there are two things. First one is, when we are writing a Java program and we are compiling, the Java compiler converts the Java program source code into bytecode, right? It is not directly converting into object code. So bytecode is translated into object code by computer's bytecode interpreter program. Now this bytecode interpreter program is known as Java Virtual Machine, that we call as JVM. So a JVM can either interpret the bytecode one instruction at a time, or the bytecode can be compiled further for the real microprocessor using that is called just-in-time compiler, that we will discuss later on. The JVM must be implemented on a particular platform before compiled programs can run on that platform. So these are the two main terms, bytecode and the Java Virtual Machine, that we will use in our coming lecture. So now next one is, this is the compilation process for Java programs. So when we write a Java program, the source code, we will save that program in a file with an extension of .java, right? Now the Java compiler compiles the source code, that means that .java extension file, into bytecode and generate a class file, that is a file with .class extension. Then the JVM translates bytecode to object code and execute the program. So we are saying that Java program is portable. So we can take the, there is no need to take the source code file to every system. We can have the .class file, and we can import that .class file on any machine, and JVM is required to execute that class file. So that's why Java is portable. Now next is, what is Java technology? Now that is a very important thing that we should know. Java technology, we can define it as Java technology as a programming language, as a development environment, as an application environment, as a deployment environment, right? So we will discuss why we are calling this Java technology as these four things. First one is Java technology is a programming language. Why we are saying this? Because the syntax of Java is similar to the syntax of C++. All kinds of applications that can be developed in C++ that we can also create with the help of Java program. So that's why Java technology is a programming language. Now next one is a development environment. We can take it as a development environment also, because as a development environment, Java technology provides you with the large suite of tools like compiler, interpreter, a documentation generator, a class file packaging tool, etc. Now next one is an application environment. Java technology applications are standalone programs that do not require a web browser to execute. They are the general purpose programs that run on any machine where Java runtime environment is installed. Now next one is a deployment environment. So we can take Java technology as a deployment environment because Java runtime environment has the deployment environment has two main tasks. First is the JRE that is supplied by the Java Software Development Kit that contains the complete set of class files for all the Java technology packages. The other main deployment environment is on the web browsers with JVM support. So that's why we call it a deployment environment. Now the syntax of Java is similar with as that of the C++, and it is used for developing applications as well as applets. Now what is the difference between applications and applets? Applications are the programs that run on your computer under the operating system of that computer only. So it is same as that of C and C++, right? Now the what are applets? An applet is an application designed to be transmitted over the internet and executed by a Java compatible web browser. So it is a tiny program dynamically downloaded across the network just like an image or file and dynamically react to the user's input. So this is the difference between applications and applets. Now next is, what are the primary goals of Java technology? Now the primary goals of Java technology, first one is, it provides an easy to use language. By how it provides an easy to use language? By avoiding many pitfalls of other languages such as pointer arithmetic and memory management. Why we are saying pointer arithmetic and memory management? Because in case of Java, we do not use pointers that's why the Java is more secure. And memory management, when we are saying memory management, in case of C and C++, it is programmer's responsibility to deallocate the memory that is no longer in use. But in case of Java, the memory management is done automatically by the garbage collector. So the term garbage collector we will discuss after this one. Now it provides an easy to use language by being object oriented, because everything in Java is object. It helps in visualizing the program in real life. It also enables users to create streamlined and clear code. Now the next goal is it provides an interpreted environment and improves the speed of development. Why it improves the speed of development? As it reduces the compile, link, load, test cycle. Code portability. It enables us to write the code that can be run on multiple operating systems on any certified JVM. Now next few goals are, it enables users to run more than one thread of activity. So that is the feature of Java. That is also a feature of Java, that is multi-threading. So that we will discuss afterwards. It loads classes dynamically at the time they are needed. So it is dynamic in nature. It furnishes better security. Why it gives better security? Because by checking the loaded port modules at runtime. So now, how to achieve these goals? The following features are required to achieve these goals. Number one is JVM. JVM is required, otherwise these goals cannot be achieved. JVM is Java Virtual Machine that we have discussed, or we have already discussed. Then the garbage collector, Java runtime environment, and JVM tool interfaces. So these are the four features that are required to achieve the goals set for the Java technology. So we have already discussed Java Virtual Machine. What is the Java Virtual Machine? It is an imaginary machine that is implemented by emulating it in software on a real machine. Now next one is garbage collector. Now what is a garbage collector? As we have already discussed, the memory that is no longer needed should be deallocated. In case of other languages, it is done by the programmer itself. Now, in case of Java, Java's garbage collector provides an automatic solution to memory management. It is under the control of the JVM. JVM decides when to run the garbage collector. For example, JVM runs the garbage collector when it senses that memory is running low. An object is eligible for garbage collection when no live thread can access it. So, garbage collector checks for and frees memory no longer needed and deallocates the memory automatically. Now, next is Java runtime environment. Java runtime environment is, you can see here the diagram, Java application environment that performs the following steps. Now, bytecode, and it will generate a dot class file, that means first dot class file. Now this class file can be imported to any system, right? So it can be loaded from the hard disk, network, or any other source. No source code is required directly because this is portable. This class file is portable. Now comes the work of JVM. So we have to execute the bytecode. We have to convert the bytecode into object code with the help of JVM. So first is the steps performed by the JVM are loading of classes, then verifying the bytecode, and then interpreting the code. Now the class loader loads all the classes needed for execution of a program. The class loader adds security by separating the namespace for the classes of the local file system from those imported from network sources. So this limits any Trojan horse application because local classes are always loaded first. So that is the advantage of a class loader, that it will not allow any virus from the network to be loaded, right? So next, then after loading all the classes, the code will go to the bytecode verifier. Now the bytecode verifier tests the format of code fragments and checks code fragments for all illegal code which forges pointers, violates access rights on objects, and attempts to change object type. Now after the verifying the bytecode, now the interpreter has two functions. It executes the bytecode and it makes the appropriate calls to the underlying hardware. So after interpreting, it will send the call to the hardware, and that code will be executed. So this is our Java runtime environment. Now you can see in the next diagram, that is the operation of JRE with a just-in-time compiler. So there is another term that has been added here, that is just-in-time compiler. So the rest of the process is same, but after verifying the bytecode, in some Java technology runtime environments, a portion of the verified bytecode is compiled to native machine code and executed directly on the hardware platform. Now this enables the Java software code to run close to the speed of C or C++ with a small delay at load time to enable the code to be compiled to the native machine. So this is the use of your Java just-in-time compiler. Now we come to the Java software development team. Now these are the terms that are needs attention, because we should know what is JSDK. JSDK is Java Software Development Kit. Now JSDK comes in three versions. First one is Java Standard Edition, that is J2SE. Now it can be used to develop client-side standalone applications or applets. So these are used only for the client-side applications, normal applications. Now second version is Java Enterprise Edition, that is J2EE. Now it can be used to develop server-side applications such as Java Servlets and Java Server Pages. Now this J2EE is used basically for the client-server interactive applications. So and the next one is Java Micro Edition, that is J2ME. It can be used to develop applications for mobile devices such as cell phones. So every version has its own significance. So if you want to create only standalone application, then J2SE is enough. Then when you want to use a client and server side interaction, then J2EE is used. And when you create applications that are that should be run on the mobile phones, then in that case you have to use Java Micro Edition. Now this Java Software Development Kit is a set of command line tools for developing Java applications. See, this JSDK is a command line tool. It is not a GUI based tool. So Java C is used for the Java compiler. Java command is used for the Java interpreter. Java C, what is the role of Java C? Java C is the Java compiler, and that is used for converting the source code into a class file. Now that class file is to be executed. That is executed with the help of Java command. So that is the Java interpreter, or you can say the JDK. Now we have already discussed what are applets. So to run the applets without a browser, applet viewer is used, and Java doc is used for automatic documentation generator, and JDB is a Java debugger. So I already told you that it is not an integrated development environment, it is a command line environment only. Now next one is integrated development environment. Now there are many IDEs available. Some are public domains and some are commercial, like Borland J Builder, Microsoft Visual J++, Web Game Cafe, IBM Visual Edge for Java, Kava. These are the IDEs that are available. Now many object oriented modeling tools such as Together, Control Center include an IDE. Most IDE offers a demo mode, so you can try anyone before you want to buy anything, right? Now next, the main thing is features of Java language. Now that is very important. So first one is simple. Why we are saying that Java language is simple? Because it is using the syntax of C and C++ and features of C++. Features of C++ means it is using encapsulation, it is using inheritance, polymorphism, like this. So it is an object-oriented language. Now it is secure. Why Java is secure? Because it provides a firewall between a network application and a user's computer. So Java compatible web browsers helps in safely downloading Java applets. Therefore, Java program is confined to the Java execution environment and not allow it to access parts of the computer. So that's why Java is secure. Now it is portable. Third feature of Java is portable. Why we are saying that Java is portable? Because as many types of computers and operating systems are in use throughout the world, and many are connected to the internet. Therefore, we want a code that can run on any type of CPU in any environment. So that is possible with the help of Java code, because JVM is providing us with this facility. Now Java is object oriented because everything in Java is an object, and based on based on the principles of encapsulation, abstraction, inheritance and polymorphs. Java is robust. That is the main reason for that is the main reason of Java being popular. That is robust. Now there are two main reasons for a program failure. First one is memory management mistakes, and second one is mishandled exception management. So we will discuss one by one. Now first one is, what are memory management mistakes? In traditional programming environment, we manually allocate and free all the dynamic all the memory. Sometimes programmers will either forget to free the memory or try to free the memory space that is in use. But in case of Java, deallocation of memory space is automatic. So Java uses the mechanism of garbage collection through which memory is deallocated automatically that is not in use. So that mistake is handled in Java. Second thing is the exception conditions. Now what are exceptions? These are the runtime errors, and like divide by zero, file not found. Now Java provides object-oriented exception handling, and all the runtime errors can be handled in a Java program. So that's why Java is robust. Now next one is multi-threaded. Now the programs that do many things simultaneously are known as multi-threaded programs. Java provides solution for multi-process that enables a constructive, interactive solution. Now what is multi-threading? Suppose we can take the example of banking transactions. Now you can withdraw or you can deposit the amount at the bank counter, or you can do the same thing at the ATM. Now suppose at the same time you are withdrawing the money from the ATM, and at the same moment somebody is depositing the money in your account. Now the application is same, but one thread is when you are having the login, a thread is generated, a different program is generated, and when somebody is depositing the account, same application is there but a thread is generated for that, and the both the transactions, whether it is withdrawal or the deposition of money, both have been done simultaneously. So that is called multi-threading. And that is possible in case of Java. That is the main feature of Java. Now next one is, it is architecture neutral. Why we are saying that it is architecture neutral? What do you understand by the architecture neutral? Sometimes it may happen that a program that runs today will not run tomorrow on the same machine. So it can happen because of any of the reasons, like operating system upgradation, processor upgradation, changes in core system resources, etc. Now JVM, that is the Java Virtual Machine, is a solution to this kind of problem. That is, with the help of JVM, we can say write once, run anywhere, anytime, forever. So Java is architecture neutral. Now it is interpreted as well as having the high performance. The bytecode can be interpreted on any machine system. So Java is designed to perform well on very low power CPUs. Just in time compiler is used with JVM to convert bytecode into executable code for very high performance. Now the it is distributed in nature. Java is distributed in nature. It is designed for the distributed environment of the internet. Now remote method invocation helps in executing procedures on remote computers, and Java provides this RMI. It is dynamic in nature. In case of applets, small fragments of bytecode may be dynamically upgraded on a running system. So it is dynamic in nature. So these are the features that are in the Java, and making it different from other languages. Thank you.